everybody. How's it going? Today we're doing something a little bit different. I am doing a double feature video. I'm going to be talking about two cartoons in one review, and I'm going to try to keep it to the main points here, keep things moving along, because I want to talk about these shows, and I want to recommend them. So, you know, right off the bat, you know that I'm already biased. The first show we're talking about today is Kipo and the Age of Wonder Beast. Now, this show came out a few weeks ago. I think it actually might have been a month by now, but it is from the folks of DreamWorks TV Animation. Funny enough, TV, that doesn't really apply anymore because, ta-da, it's on Netflix. And they've been doing a bunch of shows now for Netflix. They've got a partnership. They do that Trollhunter stuff. I believe they're the ones behind She-Ra. I still need to watch that. But Kipo is something that's completely new. I don't think it's based on a comic or book or anything, so it's 100% organic. It is about a girl named Kipo in a post-apocalyptic world. If I'm correct, it's been 200 years since right now, 2020. And they kind of just throw you into it. And I like that. And I'll try to avoid spoilers, by the way. They just throw you into the story of Kipo on the surface of Earth. She's lost. She's trying to find her way back to humanity, which is now underground. In the process, she meets other humans on the surface. She befriends them. You start to get acclimated and acquainted with all of the creatures who now live on Earth. And we don't know what happened exactly, which is one of my favorite things about the post-apocalyptic setting, is when you have to ask yourself, like, okay, how did it get to this? What happened? Adventure Time is a post-apocalyptic setting. We, as an audience, didn't even know that until the show told us, where it's like, this is after the Mushroom Wars, which heavily implies there was a nuclear holocaust. And then because of the radiation, things went whack with the life on Earth. And that's why there's so many zany, weird, alien creatures who now inhabit Earth, and why humanity is essentially gone. So I get the same vibe, by the way, with Kipo from Adventure Time, where the setting on the surface of Earth, you've got talking animals, kind of these giant like bunny monsters, basically monsters that have mutated and become new things. And some of them are sentient and can talk, like frog people, bird people, wolf people, raccoon people. They're the best. Those are my personal favorites. The raccoon people, they got like stuck on 1990s exercise culture, so they're wearing leotards and dancing to 1990s music. This show is wild, by the way. And you see that humanity is hurting, and it's actually being hunted down by this villain called, oh gosh, Charlemagne, I think was his name. I think Charlemagne actually might be like a French historical figure, so I might be butchering that up. But all in all, Kipo is just beautiful with its animation, lots of fun action, lots of fun energy. I love the designs of the characters. They really embraced the setting where it's like, this is a screwed up post-apocalyptic world that's not like Mad Max where it's all doom and gloom, but things are definitely broken and have mutated. And you see these different creatures, their personalities, how they've become accustomed to the world that they now rule. How Kipo is on the run trying to find her family, trying to get home. And also, this show's got a lot of great comedy, great dialogue back and forth, just the right mixture of characters to carry the story around. And you never know what you're going to get yourself into next, because in a world like this, you don't know what's around the corner. So Kipo, wonderful job. Oh, by the way, fantastic music. The music is one of the like hidden gems of this show. Hidden gems. Hey, Adam Sandler. It's one of the things I wasn't expecting to be as fantastic as it is. Like, you've got some shows that are like, oh, it's great music. It helps the show out. But the music for Kipo is like unreasonably good. All these songs fit so well with the characters, different themes. There's even some like lyrics thrown in there. And I love it. I've been listening to the soundtrack like on repeat for the last few weeks. It's like, listen to it for yourself. It is unreasonably good. Like, it kind of is shocking how great it is. All right, so Kipo, I recommend it. As far as like criticisms go though, it does feel very inspired by Adventure Time, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. I just like it when a show has its own unique spin on things. Oh, actually I do have a critique. It's very specific. The end of the show, which I won't spoil. By the way, this is the first season of what will be season two on the way. The way the season ended was kind of janky, where it's like they feign a conclusion and then immediately go back on it and then continue on in a way that they were going to go anyway. It's really weird to explain without spoiling it. But yeah, the ending, like the very last few minutes of the show, kind of confused me with what they're trying to do, how they feign something. So yeah, that's a critique. It kind of was janky. Glitch Techs. Okay, Glitch Techs, I've heard about you before. You were supposed to be on Nickelodeon. You were created by Nickelodeon, and then you never went to Nickelodeon. There were rumors last year of the show being canceled, which proved to be untrue, that there were layoffs. I don't know if there actually were layoffs. I assume no, because the show was completed. Though it's not uncommon for animation studios to make something, and then after they're done with their project, the studio gets axed. Rest in peace to Sonic Studio. But yes, Glitch Techs, it's on Netflix. I think it's cool that Netflix is actually like going to these different animation studios saying, hey, come make content for us. Like, we'll hire your studio to make good content for us. And I really think that's going to continue to be the case throughout this decade. We'll see how long it lasts for. But Glitch Techs, made by Nickelodeon, one of the guys who worked on Robot Chicken, is it Robot Chicken? That's the name of the show. Dan Milano, I believe. And then the guy who made Fanboy and Chum Chum, they're behind Glitch Techs. Glitch Techs itself is, the concept is, you're in a world where you've got this tech company called Hinobi, and they make video game technology, household technology, and every so often the technology itself has a glitch and it manifests itself as a digital monster that more often than not takes the form of like a video game. And this ranges from Tetris to Castlevania to fighting games. This show is a love letter to gaming. They know their stuff, and it never gets to the point where like I roll my eyes, where I'm like, oh, that gaming reference, it feels good enough where they tip their hat saying, if you know Castlevania, then you'll definitely know that we're referencing Castlevania. And if you don't, that doesn't ruin the immersion. You can still follow the show. There are bits of dialogue that makes my eyes roll, where it's like, oh, nerds, or you're about to get nerfed, or I'm stream sniping you, Twitch streamer. That stuff gets a little bit much. But again, I'm sure the kids who are watching this stuff, they love it. They can relate to it. I'm an old man shaking my cane at the sky saying, stop being so normal. But it's forgivable. I have to keep in mind that this show's also it's not just for adults, it's for everyone. I just happen to be an adult who watches cartoons. So that being said, I love the characters. Miko is the girl character. Her design's great. I love her design. I love her spunk. My friend Paleo says that her personality reminds him a lot of Star Butterfly, which I 100% agree with. Then there's other guy. I forget his name. He's kind of a bit, funny enough, it kind of reminds me of Marco as well, from Star Versus. Though not like, I think Marco's got a bit more confidence, while this guy is more nervous and anxious, but not to the point where he's like immobilized and can't act. He can also have his own spunk and quirkiness about him. But the character energy, the exchange between the two, it works. Good chemistry. I like the world. I love the designs of the characters. You got a cool broad range of different designs for these characters. They all feel pretty, well thought out. It's not like shows where it's just carbon, copies of background characters. It feels fleshed out. Same thing with the background art. Some really amazing action scenes, like wonderful flow, fluid movement. I would love to see the storyboards for this and see like how much of it, like, I want to see the storyboards. It looks very well done. Whoever edited this show, excellent job. The colors of the characters, the color in general, the lighting, fantastic. Though I am a little bit frustrated because due to folks who have epilepsy, they have to dim sections of the show that are a little bit too intense, I guess, with the lighting, which I wish there was an option we can turn that off where it's like, no, I do not have epilepsy, I can watch this. But I suppose they're playing it safe. You don't want a lawsuit, keep people from dying. But still, it's like, okay, I wish there was just at least an option. But the lighting's still great. Colors are great. The stories are fun. I love the character interactions again. The stories, it's like each episode has its own little theme of like, okay, we're talking about Super Smash Brothers this time. We're talking about Castlevania. That's my favorite episode. This Castlevania episode, like straight up, like there are some references in that episode where it's like, oh my God, you guys are nerds. You guys know Castlevania, which makes sense. Because the folks who are now making these shows are folks who grew up with video games. This is not just like a couple of folks who were born in like the 1960s who some of them might know games. These are people who were born in like the 80s and 90s who grew up with games. Like they know what they're talking about. And that kind of inspiration, that kind of passion to see it go from what they like as people and how it transfers to the screen, like for cartoons and movies. I love that. Keep that coming. I love authenticity of what folks are passionate about. And I can see that with Glitch Techs. So overall, Glitch Techs, Kipo, great shows. We've started off on a very strong foot for Netflix this year with their animation, with their cartoons. I look forward to seeing what they come up with next. It's been a good year so far, and we're only at the end of February, so we'll see what's next. All right, that's my review. Bye.